played. So, welcome to the Three Bs. We're really excited to host this evening. The Potomac River Jazz Club has been bringing traditional jazz to the DC area for 50 years, and that includes various educational components, bringing both local and external bands to the area to perform, and also maintaining a youth ensemble that helps to foster continuing the music tradition in this area. In our 50-year anniversary this year, we've had some fantastic speakers and concerts. I am going to highlight September 12th, which is our big 50th anniversary bash, and it's an all-day affair of amazing trad jazz music. It'll be here in the DC area at Rose and Steele Hall in Silver Spring, and it goes from 11 to, in essence, 7, including a jam afterwards and everything. So you've got a link to our webpage in the email we sent around earlier, and I'll also do a wrap-up email afterwards to remind everyone. But if you're local, please think about coming and inviting some friends. And even if you're not local, if you know some local folks that might be interested, please do pass that information around. We most certainly appreciate that. And then on to this evening. Ben used to live in the DC area, and he is now a New Orleans guy, and runs the gamut from classical to jazz in his playing and teaching and such. And we're really happy and lucky to have him as our speaker this evening. His website, redwinejazz.com, gives you a lot more information about him and recordings and where you can find him and all that cool stuff. So I'll also send that around to everybody, but we're in really good hands learning this evening with Ben. So without further ado, I'm going to turn over hosting to him so he can share his screen and sound and such, and also spotlight him so you don't see me anymore. And bam, it's ready to go.
All right. Well, thank you for asking me to do this, Ellie. This is exciting. When I was first asked to do this, I initially thought it would be really cool to talk a little bit about what I'm doing in New Orleans, just a little bit, and then talk about Barney Bigard and I'm losing it, the other B, Sidney Bechet. And I started doing the research on Barney Bigard and found out that he was quite an important person. So I dumped Bechet. We'll have to deal with him later if we want to deal with him. So when I lived in the DC area, most of my gigs were with two guys, Tom Mitchell and John Previty. Oh, so I guess I should say this. So this is still the three B's. So there's Ben and Barney Bigard. So when I lived in DC, I played with two guys, almost all of my gigs, Tom Mitchell and John Previty. And when I moved down here to Louisiana, there are so many venues and so many musicians that it turns out almost every gig is with a different ensemble. So there's a difference there. When I first came down here, I taught at a university for a while. So I really wasn't playing a whole lot of concerts. But then I gave that up and I just started maybe 6 months or so before the pandemic to play, you know, to search out gigs in New Orleans and around. I was at that time, I worked up to playing, I don't know, two or three or four nights a week in New Orleans, mostly on Frenchman Street. And then, of course, I remember it was March, I think it was the 17th, right in the middle of Dark Eyes, the bartender came up and said, "You're done." The pandemic hit. So we packed up and left. And I have not used Zoom. I've pretty much avoided it throughout the pandemic. So I apologize in advance if I have any technical difficulties that are my fault. So then after the pandemic restrictions started to be lifted, there weren't any gigs still. So I started manufacturing them by busking on Royal Street, which is a famous busking street. I played with a bass player several times and he said it's the best busking street in the world. He's been to, I think he said 70 countries and busked, and Royal Street is the best in the world. And then slowly the clubs started to open up. And of course the temperatures got crazy here. So I've stopped busking, but now I'm playing about three nights a week in New Orleans, and in addition to one-off gigs. So just wanted to let you know what the scene is down here that, you know, based on the epidemic and all that stuff. So, but really what I want to talk to you about is Barney Bigard. Now, Barney Bigard was always kind of in the back of my mind. I knew he was a clarinetist. I knew he played with Ellington. I knew he played with Louis Armstrong, but I didn't really know a whole lot about him. And I think it was probably because he worked for those huge luminaries, Duke Ellington and Louis Armstrong primarily. So when you think of those bands, you think of the leader, not the sideman that, that Barney Bigard was. But I really started listening to him when I was preparing for this, and he really is a fabulous player and one that really should be explored more if you don't know much about him. Now, he was born March 3rd of 1906, and his given name was Albany Leon Bigard. In his autobiography, he identifies his parents as Creoles of color, and he lists both Spanish and French as part of the mixture. His mother died while giving childbirth to him, and his father pretty quickly left town. I guess he just couldn't deal with it. He gave Barney and Barney's two older brothers to Barney's grandmother. Her name was Eugenia, and she raised him, and in fact, Barney called her mom. She shortened his name from Albany and called him Bonnie, B-O-N-N-I-E, and I guess with her accent, it sounded more like Bonnie, like B-A-W-N-I-E, which morphed into Barney. So that was his nickname and what he went by for most of his life. Bigard's uncle, a man named Emile, he was a violinist, and he was the leader of a band called Kid Ory's Creole Ragtime Band. Now, in this autobiography, Bigard says that most of the bands back then were led by violinists because those instrumentalists tended to have more education, so they could lead the band and write arrangements if they needed to. Most of the musicians weren't reading. So even though it had Kid Ory's name in the band, this violinist, the uncle of Bigard, led the band. In this band were some pretty famous musicians, Johnny Dodds and Kid Ory, of course, Pops Foster. So this band rehearsed at the house where Bigard was living with his grandmother. And so he heard this band however often they practiced. Now at some point, Bigard's father moved back to New Orleans and lived about six blocks away. So he was in Bigard's life, but not living with him. When Bigard became old enough, his father bought him a clarinet, and he bought him an E-flat clarinet because his hands were too small to play the B-flat clarinet, which is what most clarinetists play. And that piqued my interest because the same thing happened to me. When I started playing when I was 6 years old, my grandfather was a professional clarinetist, and he had me playing on the E-flat clarinet because my hands wouldn't reach. So you can see the difference in, I guess this is bad on Zoom, you can see the difference in sizes perhaps of these instruments. So the E-flat clarinet is kind of like the piccolo for the flute family, but for the clarinet family. And in fact, I played that in the Naval Academy band when I lived up near you guys. That was my chair. Once Bigard got big enough, he graduated to the B-flat clarinet, and he played an Albert system clarinet. Now, an Albert system clarinet is a different key system, and I have one here to show you. I don't know if you can see the difference on Zoom here or not, but it's a much more primitive instrument, more difficult to play. So those players back then that played on these instruments were had some obstacles to start with, some technical obstacles to start with. Bigard played in parades, and he was evidently so young that his grandmother said, well, you can march for a certain number of blocks and then you have to come home. And he started to kind of hang out with a clarinetist named Big Eye Louis Delisle. And he actually started subbing for him when Delisle didn't want to play a gig or if he was double booked, that kind of thing. In his autobiography, Bigard admits that he was not prepared for these gigs, but he played them anyway, learned the ropes on the job, and these older musicians tolerated him at least and probably taught him a lot. While he was there, he studied informally with a trumpet player named Amos White. And Amos White knew Alphonse Picou, who was a very famous clarinetist in New Orleans. And Amos White told Bigard that he could take him to meet Picou because Bigard really wanted to study with Picou. So he took him to a concert. At this time, Picou was playing in kind of a Paul Whiteman style band. And so they sat behind the orchestra so that Bigard could see Picou's music. And Bigard quickly realized that Picou was improvising everything. He wasn't reading a single note on the page. And Bigard presumed that Picou could not read music. So he kind of lost respect for him and decided he did not want to study with him. So now he heard another fabulous clarinetist in New Orleans named Lorenzo Tio. And from the accounts I've read, Lorenzo Tio actually played a clarinet in the key of A. So he's playing this Albert system clarinet because the BAME system, which is what everybody plays now, didn't exist yet. And he's playing really difficult keys, more than likely, on all of these pieces that are being played in the parades. So he was very impressive to Bigard. So Bigard started studying formally with him. After a year or so, Tio went on the road with Armand Piron's orchestra. And so he turned Bigard over to Louis Papa Tio, who was Lorenzo's uncle. So he finished studying with him. And around this time, Bigard started to play his first professional gigs, led by, in a band, let's see, it was Tom Anderson's band, led by a guy named Albert Nicholas. And in this band was a famous New Orleans family musician, Paul Barberin. He played at a place called the Spanish Fort. Today we think of the French Quarter as where everything happens in New Orleans, but this Spanish Fort is up pretty close to Lake Pontchartrain. So these opportunities were spread out evidently more so than today in New Orleans. Around Christmas time in 1924, Bigard got a cable from King Oliver inviting him to join his band in Chicago. Now, Louis Armstrong, of course, was in King Oliver's band from 1922, and he left in the springtime of 24. And in December of 24, Bigard plays in King Oliver's band. So they don't cross over there. If the music scene back then is anything like today, Armstrong and Bigard probably knew each other and played together in New Orleans before they went up to Chicago. But I didn't see any evidence of that anywhere, so I don't know for sure. The Oliver band, after Bigard started playing with them, went on tour to New York and had some misfortunes, and they decided to head to Baltimore. Now, at their first gig in Baltimore, they had a really low showing of audience members and the club refused to play them. And so the Oliver band boycotted the next performance, which was sold out, of course. And both of those instances evidently led to the Oliver band, for the most part, breaking up. Bigard says that the Oliver band limped along after that, but they were really never the same. So around this time, Bigard makes perhaps not his first recording, but a very important recording with Jelly Roll Morton's Red Hot Chili Peppers. This is from 1926. I'll play a little bit of that for you. You can hear Barney Bigard.
What's that I hear at 12 o'clock in the daytime? Church bell ringing.
Man, you don't hear no church bell ringing at 12 o'clock in the day.
Yes, indeed. Somebody must be dead.
Ain't nobody dead. Somebody must be dead drunk.
No, I think it's a funeral. Look at here, I see there is a funeral. I see right here that trombone phone.
About the same time, actually the next year, 1927, with King Oliver, he recorded this next tune called Showboat Shuffle. And in that band at this time also was Paul Barbaran, Kid Ory, and Louis Russell. Here is Showboat Shuffle, 1927. All of these recordings I found on YouTube, and you can find them later and listen to the whole thing if you want, and I'll try to give those links to Ellie to share with you later. In 1927, so right about this time that the Oliver Band basically breaks up, Bigard moves to Milwaukee and he plays with the Charlie Elgar Band. Now, with both Elgar and Oliver, he's mainly playing tenor saxophone, but as you can see from that recording, he's also playing clarinet. Same year, 1927, he leaves Elgar to go to New York to play with Louis Russell, who's a pianist, band leader. And he was, like I said earlier, he was playing also in Kid Ory. So the same musicians are playing together quite frequently. When he's playing with Russell, one night in December of 1927, Wellman Brough, spelled B-R-A-U-D, he was a New Orleanian and Duke Ellington's bass player at the time. He came to the club called The Nest, where Bigard was playing with Russell. And he asked Bigard if he wanted to join Ellington's band. Ellington had just inked the deal with the Cotton Club, so he was expanding his band. But also, the person playing clarinet was Rudy Jackson, and he had brought a piece of music to Ellington and said it was his gift. He could claim it was his, publish it if he wanted. Ellington did. That was Creole Love Call. And it turns out that Creole Love Call was actually lifted from King Oliver's Camp Meeting Blues. So Oliver sued Duke Ellington, and Oliver ended up losing the lawsuit, but I think it was because of a statute of limitations issue. So today we still think of Creole Love Call as Duke Ellington's composition, but it was really King Oliver's. So the expansion of the band and the chance to hire Bigard gave Duke Ellington an opportunity to fire Rudy Jackson, which he promptly did. And in the autobiography of Bigard, he writes that Ellington wanted someone, I'm quoting here, Ellington wanted someone to read difficult parts easily, soar above the brass without screeching, and inject an agile obbligato as a counterweight to the saxes and brass. And Bigard filled that bill. He had a beautiful sound, clear, warm tone. He phrased elegantly. Solos were inventive and interesting. He played well in tune, and he could play from the top of the instrument down to the bottom of the instrument with ease. After he spoke to Bro, Ellington invited him for an interview, and Bigard said he was talking to Ellington, and Ellington said, I don't know how long we're going to stay here, but we're going to try to build up a good band. If we can do it and the boss likes us, then we can stay here at this Cotton Club Orchestra a long time. We'll have a good job there. And Bigard says that it really struck him that Ellington was using words like our band and we, and he thought, Ellington thought of the band as a unit or as a team. And Bigard really liked that. He actually took a salary cut to join Ellington's band from Russell's, but he ended up playing with Ellington for 14 years. And his quote, Bigard's quote is, it must have been the best move of my life, I think. Bigard describes Ellington's writing style. He says that Ellington knew your limits up and down, and he would build the tinges, he called it, around a given soloist's voice. And he says, Duke was a real good leader from the start. He said, I never knew him to fire anyone, but I'll tell you, he was quite a slickster. He would make life so miserable on the job that you would want to quit. So Bigard records the first recording that has the Duke Ellington Orchestra on it. So Ellington had orchestras, bands before this time, but when he actually puts Duke Ellington on the record, this is the record, and it plays you a little bit of Jubilee Stomp. 1928. Jubilee Stomp, 1928. Now in the same year, Ellington records The Mooch, which is one of my favorite compositions by Ellington. And Ellington uses three clarinets doing this descending passage that's really right at the beginning. And then Bigard takes a low register solo. And I just love the piece so much that I want to play a little bit of that for you. Thank you. part of the mooch there. In 1929, so the following year, he made a recording with Jelly Roll Morton, with the Jelly Roll Morton Trio. And the tune they recorded on one side of the album was called Smiling the Blues Away. And I'm not going to reveal why this is interesting or important but I'm going to play this first. Get an idea there, playing with, of course, Jelly Roll Morton on piano. And then in 1931, so about 2 years later, Ellington writes Mood Indigo. And yes, here it is. And so Mood Indigo has two sections. The second section is credited to Bigard, but did a little bit of digging and it turns out most likely Lorenzo Tio, his clarinet teacher, wrote that section, not Bigard. Tio gave, evidently gave Bigard a stack of music, asked him if he would give it to Ellington after Bigard started playing with Ellington, and Ellington, for whatever reason, attributed it to Bigard and got published that way, and that there's history, but a pretty compelling evidence that it was actually written by Lorenzo Tio, not Barney Bigard. But here is Mood Indigo. Now, this recording is very interesting to me coming from a New Orleans standpoint because Ellington basically uses the traditional New Orleans frontline, trumpet, trombone, and clarinet, and he flips them over. So the trombone has the high part, the clarinet has the low part. And this here is Mood Indigo. Here's the second section. Okay, I'm gonna stop it there because I'm looking at the time. I think I'm gonna run out of time here. Okay, so the Cotton Club gig ended that same year, 1931. And the Ellington Orchestra essentially became a traveling orchestra. In 1936, Barney Bigard, with his Jazzopaters, made a recording under his name. And this is interesting for the same reason that it was interesting that Bigard played with Jelly Roll Morton earlier. And on this recording, in fact, Duke Ellington is playing the piano. Let's play a little bit of that for you. This is actually the first time Caravan is recorded. under Barney Bigard's name, not Duke Ellington's, even though Juan Tizol wrote that. There it is. Bigard plays a solo later on, but as I said, I'm kind of, looks like I'm running out of time. So the reason that's interesting is on this recording, Bigard is the leader of the band, even though Duke Ellington's playing piano. And in the Jelly Roll Morgan session, Ellington has allowed Bigard to record with another band. Most band leaders did not let their musicians do that while they were playing with their band at this time. And I think that Ellington was trying to keep all of his star players happy and to have them stay with his band and not go off on their own solo career, because he just knew how special they were. So he would also write feature numbers for his soloists. And he wrote one, in fact, in 1936 for Barney Bigard called Clarinet Lament. And on the flip side of that album is Echoes of Heaven, written for Cootie Willis. This harmonic structure is based on Basin Street Blues, and let's hear the clarinet lament. So this one has a nod.
That Starbucks coffee feeling, made ready.
Thank you.
Clarinet lament. Now, at some point, Bigard became tired of touring and he quit the Ellington band in 1942 and lived in Los Angeles, recuperating from the road, as he put it. Now, after about a month of retirement, he started his own band at a club called the Capri, owned by Billy Berg. Bigard put a band together, including a relatively unknown bassist at the time, Charles Mingus. At this time, Bigard ran into Kid Ory, who at that time had not fared well from the Depression. And Bigard invited him to play with his band, which he did. At the time, Ory had been a cook and a janitor at the city morgue. And after Ory played a few times with Bigard, Bigard encouraged Ory to reform his band, which he did. But Bigard did not join it, but Ory started his band again. In 1947, Bigard received a call from Louis Armstrong's manager asking to put a, what they call an all-star band together to film a movie called New Orleans. And I think you can see that entire movie on YouTube, or maybe you can rent it, I'm not sure. But the manager, Louis's manager was Joe Glazer, and he suggested putting a small band together for that movie and suggested getting big names to back Billie Holiday's singing. He got Louis Armstrong, Barney Bigard, Kid Ory, Charlie Beal on piano, Bud Scott on guitar, Red Callender on bass, and Zudi Singleton on drums. Now the film industry people knew these musicians and thought they would really help the film. And in fact, they were very popular. And the Louis Armstrong All-Stars were born. The iteration of that after the movie was Louis Bigard, Jack Teagarden, Sid Catlett, Dick Carey on piano, Arvel Shaw on bass, and Velma Middleton was the vocalist. And I've never done this before. I'm going to try to share my screen here and show you just a little bit of a different film called The Strip. So this all-star band was featured in a lot of films at this time. And this one's called The Strip. I'll just play a little bit of that for you. So see if I can figure this out.
There was three children from the land of Israel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Took a trip to the land of Babylon, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Nebuchadnezzar was the king of Babylon, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Took a lot of gold and made an idol, Shadrach.
All right, I've completely lost it now.
arrow again.
Hit what arrow?
The forward arrow go up a little bit. You just hit the backwards arrow. Go left, 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 right, right. The
Got it. Okay, sorry. Yeah. And then that the drop down was in front of the YouTube screen, so I couldn't make the screen big. Sorry, that's my ignorance about Zoom. Sorry about that. Anyhow, that's just an example of, it was a 1950 film that the band was in and featured in. The band opened up at Billy Berg's Capri, the same club that Bigard was playing. So my assumption is that Bigard made that happen. So they worked out their kinks and then they started touring extensively. Bigard quit the All-Star Band on three occasions, but came back on those three occasions. So he played on and off with the All-Star Band for 7 years. He finally left in 1961. Now, I think I skipped a recording I wanted to play for you, which was interesting to me because, here it is. This is a band put together by Rex Stewart, who was Ellington's trumpet player at the time. And when they were on tour in Paris, they met up with Django Reinhardt, and they recorded this with Django Reinhardt. Django's a big idol of mine, so this is interesting to me.
Welcome back to A Slice of Life, sorry. Topped with extra smiles.
I fast forward all these, but they didn't today. For some reason. Reinhardt. Now, one of the times that he had quit the All-Star Band, he recorded an album, Barney Bigard did, and this is a tune that he evidently wrote. It is called Louisiana and Me, and it is based on Up a Lazy River. So here is a little bit of that. Same album is 27 years after Mood Indigo was recorded with Ellington. He records Mood Indigo again on the same album. So let's hear his take on it 27 years later.
Mm-hmm.
Perhaps a more melancholy mood indigo 27 years later. 26 years later. When Bigard was playing with Louis the last time, Duke Ellington and Louis made a record. And that's interesting to me because these were Bigard's two main bosses throughout his career. It's called Louis Armstrong and Duke Ellington Together for the First Time, recorded in 1961. Which is the same year that Bigard left Louis' band for the last time. And you can hear that, I believe you can hear that entire album on YouTube. Now, after he left Louis' band, he settled again in Los Angeles and he played at Ben Pollock's Pick-A-Rib on the Sunset Strip. He hired a band and Teagarden joined him, Jack Teagarden. They played there with rotating trumpet players and pianists for a year or so. At that time, Teagarden formed his own band again. He asked Bigard to join him, but Bigard was he's done with the road. So he just said he declined. He stayed there in Los Angeles. Now, in doing this research, it's interesting. I ran into a man in New Orleans who actually co-wrote Barney Bigard's autobiography. And his name is Barry Martin. Martin spelled with a Y at the end there. He's written six or seven books about the history of jazz, including his co-writing credit for Barney Bigard's autobiography. And I met with him, and my wife Leslie and I, we interviewed him and got a lot of background information on Bigard's life. And Barry Martin, he actually played drums, he was a drummer. And he was a promoter also in Los Angeles at the time. And he produced this 70th birthday in Los Angeles for Louis Armstrong in 1970 called Hello Louie. And it's probably a pretty famous and popular event. So you've probably seen some footage of it or heard some of it. But Louis had been sick, so he was not supposed to play. He was just going to come there and maybe perhaps say a few things in the microphone. And in fact, he mugged on stage with a Hoagy Carmichael. And then Bigard was getting ready to play Sea Jam Blues, one of his signature tunes. And Barry Martin, this man that I met, he said within the first measure, Louis had had enough. He was sitting next to Barry Martin backstage and he said, Louis Armstrong's legs were just twitching and he was obviously agitated. He'd had enough. He couldn't stand anymore. He ran out on stage, took the microphone, stopped the band, and evidently let out an expletive saying that that was a long run across the stage. And he ended up singing Hello Dolly and a few other tunes on stage, even though he really wasn't supposed to. Of course, Louis died the next year, 1971. Bigard, after that time period, he played some big performances, some small performances. He traveled to France, and he headlined another couple of festivals that Barry Martin produced. One was called A Night in New Orleans, and they actually went on the road with that a little bit, and then Los Angeles Jazz Festival. Now, in 1975, Bigard formed what he called the Pelican Trio, with Duke Burrell playing piano and Barry Martin playing drums. So Barry Martin played with Bigard for the last 5 years or so of his life. They did some small tours with that group, and they played a lot in Los Angeles. And in fact, Barry Martin was sitting bedside when Barry Martin was sitting bedside when Bigard was basically in his deathbed and in a comatose state, more or less. And Bigard's wife had been sitting there for 19 hours, so she went home to get some rest. And Bigard woke up, pointed to his wedding ring, couldn't talk, and Barry Martin relays that he understood. He wanted him to take the ring and make sure his family got it, and an undertaker or a hospital worker didn't get his ring. And he passed away on June 27th, 1980. Now, from this research, I became very interested in Barney Bigard, and I'm actually going to play a tribute concert to Bigard on August 3rd on the north side of Lake Pontchartrain. And Barry Martin's going to play drums with me that day, as well as a pianist. And my great friend, John Previty, who lives in your area, happens to be coming through. So he's going to be playing with me that day too. Really looking forward to it. The first set I'm going to be devoting to Ellington music, and the second set to Louis Armstrong music. And anyhow, I've just had a blast researching Barney Bigard, and wanted to thank you, Ellie, again for inviting me to do this. It's great to see people's faces that I haven't seen in several years. And that's it. You're welcome to ask me questions, evidently. I think I've told you everything I know about everything already, but you're welcome to ask questions.
This has been really interesting. I love it. I have a question coming from my dabbling in various woodwinds. What about that? What, did you see it was Albert? What was the name of that other clarinet?
Yes, Albert. It was the Albert system.
Albert system. So are there less feet? Like, tell me the... Okay, so I can pick up a flute, I can pick up a saxophone, pretty much the fingering is so similar, right? Then you get to the clarinet and my eyes go across and I always have to pick up the fingering chart. So, yeah, okay. There are sort of less feet, different feet.
Yeah, keys. Definitely, yes, definitely, yes. Less keys. It's kind of laid out more like a recorder.
Yes.
Than a modern day clarinet. And Bigard never switched to the BAME system, and almost everybody else did, because the BAME system is easier to play, and it allows you to have alternate fingering, so you can play.
Yeah.
When you go from one note to another, sometimes on clarinet, it's difficult, and so with those alternate fingerings, you can make it more easy. But he just, I don't know, can't teach an old dog new tricks, maybe. He just never made the switch.
Yeah, fascinating. We have one question in the chat from Seth. He was asking if the Bigard concert might be live streamed, and maybe the PRJC could co-sponsor or something. He wants to see it as the bottom line. I was thinking the same thing. I'm like, I wish I could see that. Anybody setting up a device to live stream or record it to put on YouTube or anything like that?
I hadn't really thought about it. You can see how technologically adept I am at Zoom, so I may fail, but I'll try.
It'd be cool to try, because I wish I could see that. It sounds fantastic. Yeah. Really, really loved that second take on Mood Indigo. I mean, the whole point is being blue, right? I mean, it's a sad feeling. I thought that was a beautiful version. I don't think I've heard that. Do we have some other questions? I see Tim has his microphone on.
Yep. Ben, I'm just a PRJC member, not a musician or anything, but I smoked a cigar with Barry Martin way back about 12, 13 years ago. So I know he's from England originally.
Yes.
But he's been in New Orleans for about 60 years. So I assume he must have been really young when he went there. So he's got to be approaching 80 or close to it.
He is 80, and he's still smoking that cigar.
Okay, and still drumming and everything else.
Yeah, and he was doing he was actively playing up until the beginning of the pandemic. He said he's so excited to play this concert because he hasn't played since March of 2020. What else did you say about? Oh, I think he's been in New Orleans about 16 years.
Oh, 16 total. Because I know he's been here on this side of the Atlantic for a long time. So
yeah, and he was in Los Angeles before. He lived in Los Angeles. Yeah. Okay.
So well, I probably started seeing him about 15 years ago, and he was doing some kind of, it was a pickup band, but it was in one of the hotels. I can't remember which one. And he had several cigars in his pocket, and I said, "Oh, during a break, you're a cigar smoker." He said, "Yes, I am," and I said, "So am I." He said, "Would you like one of these? And I'll sit down with you after, and we can sit out in the patio there and have a good old cigar." So I'll never forget that. You know, that was pretty cool. That was really a neat thing. Yeah.
I met him again about, I don't know, 3 or 4 days ago, and he had, I think, 4 cigars in his ashtray on his desk.
Okay, so he's still going strong.
Yeah, in various stages of length from being lit, yeah.
Because he lives in the Quarter, am I correct? Yeah,
he lives in Bywater, so pretty close to the French Quarter.
Oh, okay. Mm-hmm. Oh, thank you.
Yeah.
That's really cool. Do we have any other questions? Feel free to either type them in the chat or turn your microphone on and shout them out. All right, I'm going to give that a few more seconds, but looks like that might be about it. So just a couple of quick reminders to everybody. We put this out for free, but we do appreciate any donations anybody wants to put in, because we do pay our speakers. This is just a little outreach thing for us and something we find interesting and fun, and we've really been enjoying offering all of this. I found really fascinating personally, because we had a talk on Kid Ory from McCusker, and we've had, you know, all the different people that have done talks. I found, as I was listening to some of the stories that you were telling, some of that coming full circle. I'm like, oh yeah, when Ory was in LA, and when the, you know, and all of that. So I thought, I don't know, just coming to all of these each time has been really educational and interesting, and really, really enjoyed the presentation. Seth says, great job. Thanks so much for doing this. I'm a pretty big Bigard fan, but I still learned a bunch of new things, and I learned lots of new things. So thank you so much, and thanks everybody who came to watch and listen. And I always say we're gonna post it on YouTube within a couple of days, and we'll send the we is me, and I work a lot of hours, so it's gonna come out. Just give me a couple of days, and I usually send a follow up email, and if Ben throws a few of those links over, I know some of those older recordings, the quality of them can waver and stuff, and particularly on replays. So we'll send those around to everybody if you want to do a longer listen or repeat any of those, and you can take your time with those and listen as much as you want. And that'll wrap us up for tonight. So thank you so much, Ben, for doing this. We really appreciate it.
If anyone wants to friend me on Facebook, that's when I will announce whether I can figure out the live stream thing.
Great. That'd be awesome. And if I catch that, you know, Facebook shows you what they want to show you sometimes, but if you think of it, tag me, and I'll try to keep an eye out for it too, because I'll try to share it onto the PRJC page too, and try to steer some traffic that way if we can. So
if you want to visit my website, which is redwinejazz.com, it has my contact information. You're welcome to call or email, whatever.
Awesome. Thanks so much, everybody. And still working out some logistics for our September talk, but if I have that together before I send the email out, I'll also include that. But we always put it up on our website and Facebook page and all of that stuff. So great. Have a good night, everyone. Thank you so much.
Everybody stay healthy.